As part of our worship, we're going to turn to Psalm 91. Psalm 91, I'm going to read verses 1 and 2. He who dwells in the shelter of the Most High will abide in the shadow of the Almighty. I will say to the Lord, my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust. This morning as we come to worship, we are invited to dwell with God, to abide in Him. Because He is our refuge and our fortress. In other psalms we read that He is our strength. He is our portion. And we're called to trust Him. Yeah. Our God. The one who meets all our needs. The one in whom we abide. The one in whom we dwell with this day. Shall we pray before we sing? Lord God, we just come to you just now, and we thank you for this day. We thank you that we get to worship you together as your people. We thank you, Lord, that you invite us into your family, Lord, that you invite us to dwell with you, to abide in you, to rest in you, because you are our fortress, you are our safety, you are our stronghold. God, help us to trust in you this day. In your name, Lord, I pray. We're going to sing together two songs just now. The first one, In Christ Alone, and the second one, All Heaven Declares. Please stand to sing.
Thank you.
We're going to turn to John chapter 19 as we share together just now. This is while Jesus is on the cross. It says, after this, Jesus, knowing that all was now finished, said, to fulfill the scriptures, I thirst. A jar full of sour wine stood there, so they put a sponge full of the sour wine on a hyssop branch and held it to his mouth. When Jesus had received the sour wine, he said, it is finished. And he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. What was finished? As Jesus hung there and died on the cross. What was finished was a perfect sacrifice, the payment for sin. It was finished. It was paid in full. Our reconciliation with the Father was finished. Because of his obedience in going to the cross. Our adoption into the family as co-heirs with Christ is finished because of the work of Christ on the cross. Our entry into God's kingdom is finished because of his completed work on the cross. And it is finished because of him. Not because of what we do, but because of what he did. He willingly sacrificing himself in our place. It's that that we remember today. It is finished. Do you believe that? Do you trust that? Do you rest in that just now? If so, I invite you to share with me as we remember Christ's broken body. Lord, we thank you, Lord, that you willingly went through that pain and that suffering in allowing your body to be broken so our lives doesn't have to. Lord, so that we can share life with you. Shall we pray? Lord God, as we open up your word in just a few moments' time, Lord, we pray, Lord, that you will help us to understand these passages, Lord, that we're going to be reading. Lord, I pray, Lord, that as you help us understand, you will also show us how to walk closely with you, Lord, this week in light of what we're learning. Lord, I pray for the children and the teachers as they go out as well. Lord, we thank you, Lord, for their vibrancy. Lord, we thank you, Lord, for the teachers' willingness to teach your word to our children. Lord, we pray, Lord, that you will equip them as well. And Lord, as they learn, Lord, that not only will they hear the words, but Lord, that they will see life with you modeled through us. As we live with you, in your name, Lord, amen. The children are going to head out, and we are going to take Hebrews chapter 1. Hebrews chapter 1, and I'm starting at verse 1, and I'm going to read through to verse 2, chapter 2 as well, sorry. So if there's two, you can click on to each slide there as we read. Long ago, at many times and in many ways, God spoke to our fathers by the prophets, but in these days, In these last days, he has spoken to us by his Son, whom he appointed the heir of all things, through whom he also created the world. He is the radiance of the glory of God, and the exact imprint of his nature, and he upholds the universe by the word of his power. After making purification for sins, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high, having become as much superior to angels as the name he has inherited is more excellent than theirs. For to which of the angels did God ever say, "You are my son, today I have begotten you"? Or again, "I will be to him a father, and he shall be to me a son"? And again, when he brings the firstborn into the world, he says, let all God's angels worship him. Verse 7. Of the angels, he says, he makes his angels wings, and his ministers a flame of fire. But of the Son, he says, your throne, O God, is forever and ever. The scepter of uprightness is the scepter of your kingdom. You have loved righteousness and hated wickedness. Therefore, God, your God, has anointed you with the oil of gladness beyond your companions. And you, Lord, laid the foundation of the earth in the beginning, and the heavens are the work of your hands. They will perish, but you remain. They will all wear out like a garment, like a robe, you will roll them up. Like a garment, they will be changed. But you are the same, and your years will have no end. And to which of the angels has he ever said, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies a footstool for your feet? Are they not all ministering spirits sent out to serve for the sake of those who are to inherit salvation? Chapter 2. Therefore, we must pay much close attention to what we have heard, lest we drift away from it. For since the message declared by angels proved to be reliable, and every transgression or disobedience received a just retribution, how shall we escape if we neglect such a great salvation? It was declared at first by the Lord, and it was attested to us by those who heard, while God also bore witness by signs and wonders and various miracles and by gifts of the Holy Spirit distributed according to his will, the founder of salvation. For it was not to angels that God subjected the world to come, of which we are speaking. It has been testified somewhere. What is man that you are mindful of him, or the son of man that you care for him? You made him a little lower than the angels. You crowned him with glory and honor, putting everything in subjection under his feet. Now, in putting everything in subjection to him, he left nothing outside his control. At present, we do not yet see everything in subjection to him. But we see him who for a little while was made lower than the angels, namely Jesus, crowned with glory and honor because of the suffering of death, so that by the grace of God he might taste death for everyone. Verse 10. For it was fitting that he, for whom and by whom all things exist, in bringing many sons to glory, should make the founder of their salvation perfect through suffering. For he who sacrifices and those who are sanctified all have one sort. That is why he is not ashamed to call them brothers, saying, I will tell of your name to my brothers. In the midst of the congregation I will sing your praise, and again I will put my trust in him. And again, behold, I and the children God has given me. Since, therefore, the children share in flesh and blood, he himself likewise partook of the same things, that through death he might destroy the one who has the power of death, that is the devil, and deliver all those who through fear of death were subject to lifelong slavery. For surely it is not angels that he helps, but he helps the offspring of Adam. Therefore he had be made like his brothers in every respect, so that he might become a merciful and faithful high priest in the service of God, to make propitiation for the sins of the people. For because he himself has suffered when tempted, he is able to help those who are being tempted. Amen. Last week we started our series on Hebrews, and we looked at the first four verses of chapter 1, and we looked at the book of Leviticus as well. If you haven't listened to last week's sermon, it's up on our website, it's on our Facebook channel, and it's on our YouTube channel as well. So just search Bible Baptist Church and you'll find it if you haven't already. One of the things I encourage people last week to do is actually go through the book of Hebrews to read it alongside the book of Leviticus, particularly when we get into the law chapters in the next couple of weeks, to read it alongside, and it will help you understand what the writer is alluding to and what from Leviticus is pointing to Christ and how he links the two it will really help us understand it. It will also give you a fresh appreciation of the Old Testament and the first five books particularly of the Old Testament. This week we're really starting to dig a little deeper into the book of Hebrews. And as we do that, thank you, Stuart. As we do that, just by way of introduction, just want to remind you of the structure of the book of Hebrews. Chapter 1, verses 1 to 3 is the introduction, and we looked at that, as I said, last week. And this introduction really is a synopsis of the whole gospel. It tells us who Christ is and why he has come, basically. And from there, he unpacks his theology based on what we read in those first three or four verses of chapter 1. And the rest of chapter 1, the whole of chapter 2, which we read today, he is contrasting Jesus. And in chapters 1 and 2, he's contrasting Jesus to angels and the giving of the Torah, the law. And in chapters 3 and 4, he contrasts Jesus to Moses, who received the law and the promised land. So leaving slavery into the land of rest. And in chapters 5 through 7, he compares Jesus to the priesthood, to the priestly system, and Melchizedek, this strange figure we come across in Genesis. And in chapters 6 to 7, he contrasts Jesus between sacrifice and the covenant. So the sacrificial system and the old covenant, and the covenant that we receive in Christ. And chapters 11 to 13, it's a call to remain faithful to the author of life, Jesus. And the main aims of Hebrews is to show that Jesus is higher than all of creation. And so he's worthy of trust and devotion. And he challenges us to remain faithful to him despite persecution. And he reminds us that God will remain faithful to you through his covenant in Christ Jesus. And so today we're going to be looking at how Jesus is superior to angels and the law of Torah. And so we're going to be looking at, first of all, the person, work, and status of the Son. We're going to look at who he is, what he does, and what is his status. We're going to look at how the Son is exalted over and above the angels and the law. And we're going to look at how, in contrasting Jesus to these, that we are called to remain faithful. Because after the end of each section, the writer reminds us to remain faithful. So at the end of each section, we're going to see how this section helps us to remain faithful. So let's delve in. The person, work, and status of the Son. The writer identifies the Son, or the person of the Son, as Jesus in chapter 2, verse 9. He says, when he's talking about the Son, he says, "This is Jesus. I'm talking to you about Jesus, the one we've all heard about. That's who I'm talking about when I'm writing these things and I'm telling you what the position that the Son holds in God's kingdom and in our lives. I'm talking to you about Jesus. He has a name. We can place him in history." So he leaves us with no ambiguity about who he's talking about. We can't say the Son is somebody else. Or that Jesus wasn't the Son. He was a good man, but he wasn't the Son of God. We cannot say that, according to the writer of Hebrews. He identifies Jesus of Nazareth as the Son of God. And he says that the Son, the person of the Son, is equal to God. When quoting the Psalms and saying that when he's contrasting Jesus to the angels, and he says, since when has God said this to the angels? He says, "You are righteous, you are holy, you are God," quoting the Psalms. So he's equating the Son to God. And so therefore we're given a glimpse of the Trinity here. And we're reminded that though God is one, he is three persons. And in human language and in human understanding, that is difficult for us to understand. It's difficult for us to put into words that actually does it justice. And we're reminded that God says, "My words are greater than yours. My thoughts are greater than yours. My ways are greater than yours." You cannot begin to understand them. And this is where faith comes in, isn't it? Where we trust, where we take God at his word. This is his self-revelation of who he is. And the writer of Hebrews says, part of God's self-revelation is the Son, who is God. And as God, the Son is the author of creation. He's the image of God. If you want to know what God looks like, look to the Son. Look to Jesus. He is the authority of God. He is the Word of God. Chapter 1, verses 1 to 3. We can also look at John chapter 1 as well, the Gospel of John. And we see the person of the Son as God. We also see that he is Jesus, the man who walked this earth. He was both fully God and fully man. How God managed to accomplish that, only he knows. When we read Hebrews, when we read the whole of Scripture, we see that that is what God is telling us. So we put our trust in it, we believe it. And we let him reveal how he did it to us in good time, if he wants to. So we come to the work of the Son. And there's a sense in which we've already been looking at the person, but we've had to delve into some of that as well. But that's the Son's work as pre-existent Son. when we're talking about the work of the Son in this context, in the book of Hebrews, we're actually really talking about his work on earth. As I said, one of the ways in which the Son works is that he shows us what God is like. He helps us to understand him in ways in which it was impossible to prior to Christ's coming. Prior to the person of Jesus being born and growing up and showing us and living that God glorifying life, living a pure life, a holy life, a sinless life. He shows us what God is like. He shows us God's compassion for his creation. He shows us his desire for us to put him first in all things. He shows us the importance of living a God-honoring, a holy life set apart for him. He shows us his character, his nature. We see that the work of Christ is to uphold all of creation together. You've got to remember, even though the writer to Hebrews was probably writing to Jewish Christians, hence the name of the book, and his obvious assumption that his readers understood the law inside and out, because of the way he deals with it, that's a fair assumption to make. He's also writing in a time when Greek philosophy and a myriad of religions was prevalent in the known world at the time. And one of these Greek mythologies was about the god Atlas, who held the world up in his hands. The writer to Hebrews is not saying that's what Jesus does. He's actually distinguishing Jesus from this mythology as well. When he says that he holds all of creation together. What he is saying is he is the author of creation, he is the perfecter, he is the sustainer of all things. That as the one who holds creation together, he holds it together through divine authority. A bit like how a government works, where he sets the boundaries of law and order. He sets the boundaries on what it means to live in God's creation. And if you want to honor God, these are the boundaries in which you live. But more than that, he sets the boundaries of nature, of science, how things work. The writer tells us that's the work of the Son. And it is his because he has been given it as his inheritance by the Father. So it's not like ancient mythologies or New Age religions that are creeping in again today. But it's different. But he upholds a whole of creation together. He is the author of our salvation. He deals with sin through his death. He brings about righteousness. Brings about our righteousness before God. Just as God declared Abraham righteous because he trusted him, so So, by trusting in the death of Jesus, God declares us righteous because of Jesus. He inaugurates, the Son inaugurates our sanctification. That is, being made into the image of the Son, so that when we enter into our final rest with Him, we are comfortable as members of the family. He's the one who inaugurates it through His death and His resurrection and His ascension. And He serves us at the right hand of God as our high priest. He serves us before the Father as our high priest. So we come to His status. We see in the writing of Hebrews that He uses this term that God appointed the Son, Jesus, to be heir of all things. And yet we read He was pre-existent and He was the agent of God in creating what God spoke and Jesus as the Word did in creation. We see that in John's Gospel as well. So how is He appointed heir if He pre-existed and He was God before the creation of the universe? First of all, the writer is not denying His pre-existence. In fact, he goes out of His way to prove that Jesus is pre-existent, to remind us of who He was before He came as the person of Jesus. He is appointed heir, He is appointed son, He is appointed and given an inheritance of all of creation. He is saying that through His completed work on the cross, the Father gives Him this inheritance because He was faithful up to the point of death. In Philippians chapter 2, we read that even though He was God, He doesn't consider equality with God, since He grasped and made Himself nothing and became obedient even to the point of death. And because of that, God gives Him. And He goes on, we'll look at that in a moment. You see, Jesus, the Son of God, still needed to be obedient to the Father. And because He was, God is pleased to give Him everything that was His by right, but to give it to Him as a gift. It's a bit like earthly inheritance, really, isn't it? Particularly in the ancient world, the oldest son, and as the oldest son in my family, this would have been my lot in ancient times. We don't do it quite so much like that now, do we? Where the oldest son would receive pretty much everything the father had. It was his upon death, and it was rightfully his. Sometimes the father would give it begrudgingly because the son wasn't a very good son. And today, when things are maybe spread out a bit more evenly between all siblings, it actually can often cause a bit of infighting and discord in families because of why did you get this, why didn't I get that, or whatever. But with Jesus, God willingly gives Him His inheritance because He was the perfect Son. because he lowered himself and became obedient to death, even death on the cross. Therefore, as Paul says in Philippians, the writer in Hebrews tells us, therefore, he receives a name that is above every name. Philippians chapter 2, verse 9. So what is the name that he receives? Well, he receives the name of Jesus. The Son receives the name of Jesus. Jesus receives the name of the Son. But it also goes beyond that because he receives the name, which was a title given only to God. In Jewish literature, in Jewish thought, in Jewish conversation. Because God was so holy, so magnificent, that we couldn't even utter his actual name. And when you see it written down, if you see it written down at all, you will see it written down without the vowels in, or you will simply see the name written. The writer of Hebrews is reminding us that Jesus receives the name of God. The name. He receives the status of being God because he was obedient. He receives the status of being high above all things. Because of his obedience. And in Jesus, we see God's greatest glory, and we see his humility. So we see Jesus' status as one of glory and one of humility. It's remarkable that as God, he gave up his glory to become human and to die. And because he did that, he received the greatest status there is. That one day, every knee shall bow and declare him as Lord. That is the status of the Son. The writer of Hebrews says, which angel has ever received that? Which angel has ever received that? When did the law receive that status? Never did. Because it weren't meant to. Only the Son was meant to. And so the Son has been given that status. Therefore, we are to exalt the Son higher than anything else, higher than the given law, higher than the angels, who are spiritual beings, yes. They serve God in heaven, they do his bidding. But the Son is higher. The Son is greater. Don't worship men. Don't worship the law. Worship the Son. Jesus. So we move on to our next point. The exaltation of the Son over the angels and the law. The writer of Hebrews in chapter 1, verses 1 and 2, and we looked at this a little bit last week, is reminding us that Jesus is a continuation of the revelation of God in the Old Testament. That it's a continuation, that we are moving on, that God is revealing himself He, in an even more deeper and intimate way than he has in the past, he's not sending his messages, he's coming to be the messenger. He's coming to be the message as the Son. So Jesus is a continuation of all that has gone before. Remember last week we looked at the certain sects within Judaism that worshipped angels, that even thought of angels as being more important and more exalted than the Son, the Messiah. And the writer of the Hebrews is trying to correct that theology to get things in the right order. And a lot of these thoughts actually come from Deuteronomy, in traditional Jewish thought, based on Deuteronomy 33. The Jews interpreted that as God giving Moses the law by his angels. That God gave Moses the law through the angels. And one of the reasons for this is because angels were seen as God's messengers, the ones who came to deliver special revelations. And we see it as the angels come and declare to Mary that she's going to have a baby, to Elizabeth. We see it in the Old Testament with Samson and so on and so forth. But the angels were God's messengers. And the law, the Torah, was God's word to humanity. So they were both very highly esteemed, and rightly so, because they come from God. That through them, God reveals himself to his people. They were active agents in redemption. The redemption of God's people from slavery in Egypt through to rest in the promised land. Of course, as we read on in Hebrews read on in the first five books of the Old Testament, we see that the generation that actually left Egypt, only two of them enter the promised land. Joshua and Caleb. Because they're the only two who trusted God from that generation. Completely, 100%. Other than Moses, who didn't go in because of his own sin, wasn't granted rest in this life, in the promised land. But the angels and the giving of the law were supposed to point us towards Jesus. The angels themselves are only ever messengers. They're only ever giving a message that's been given to them to give to us. They are not the revelation itself. They are ministers. But in Jesus, the writer of Hebrews reminds us that we have the word of God directly. And so therefore, he is greater than the angels, he is greater than the law. He is greater because he is the messenger, because he is the message, because he is the self-revelation of the Father. He is redemption in action. He's not pointing towards it, he is it. And the thing that is it is always greater than the thing that points to it. He is greater because he is God. He is greater because through Christ, God created the world. As God spoke, the Word, Jesus, did. John chapter 1, verse 1. In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God. The Word was God. Through Him, all things were made. And so we are called to remain faithful to this one who is great, to the Son, the one who is exalted high above all things because He was obedient. He's been given the name that is above every name, that one day every knee will bow and declare Him Lord. Now is the time to remain faithful. The writer was writing at a time when persecution was just starting to ramp up. As I said last week, it was maybe 2 years, 3 years absolute maximum before the destruction of Jerusalem and the temple in AD 70. Maximum 3 years before. It could even be months. He's writing at a time when persecution is starting to ramp up. And he's saying to those who are reading his letter, those he's written to, now is the time to remain faithful. Do not give up. If Jesus is all of this, and you turn your back on all of this, do you think you will get a better outcome than the children of Israel were when they left Egypt? Refused to trust God every step of the way and failed to enter into the rest of the promised land, do you think you will get a better outcome than that? If you turn your back on Christ now? And so we're confronted with the possibility of turning our back on the author of salvation. Being saved from slavery but failing to enter our rest. I would count on to say, if you truly met with Him, why would you want to? When you truly know the author of salvation, when you truly know the author of creation, when you truly know what it is to be His and to be saved from all that we have been saved from. Those who truly put their trust in God entered Caleb and Joshua. And it's a call to remain faithful. As Israel was called to remain faithful to the covenant that they entered into with God on Mount Sinai, as God gave them the law, so we are called to remain faithful to the covenant we have in Jesus. For the Israelites to remain faithful, they needed to know the law. They needed to know it said that they were told to write it on their doorpost, to have it hanging on their tassels. They needed to know it. They needed to study it. They needed to memorize it. They needed to pay attention to it. It wasn't just good enough to know it word for word. They had to pay attention to it. So when they're confronted with a situation and they know God's word says X and they want to do Y, that they do X. They had to pay attention to it. They needed to listen to it. They needed to obey it. And so we, in order to remain faithful to Jesus, we need to know Him. We cannot remain faithful to him if we do not know him intimately, inside and out. We know all about him. We know his heart. We know his nature. We know his wisdom. And to do that, we need to pay attention to him. We need to dwell with him, we read in Psalms at the beginning. We need to abide in him, to rest in him. We need to pay attention, we need to listen, we need to obey. We need to go where he is going. Because it's going to become a time when we're actually going to be confronted with a choice. Do we stand with Christ, or do we stand with this world? Do we stand with Christ, or do we stand with this world? There is coming a time when that will be made plain, that choice will be made plain to us. But it's a choice each one of us has to make every day anyway. In every situation, are you going to remain faithful? And in Hebrews we have a warning. A warning that if we, like the Israelites in the wilderness, fail to remain faithful, fail to trust God, to take him at his word, to believe him, we, like them, can fail to enter the rest that has been promised us. For those who remain faithful, for those who remain in him. Yes, we can have rest now. It's a rest from having to strive. It's a rest from having to prove ourselves to God. Because in Christ we have been proved. If we trust him, if we remain in him, we receive our salvation. And so therefore we can rest in that now. But ultimately it's full rest in eternity. We know that everything here is a pale image, a pale imitation of what it's going to be like in the new heaven and the new earth. When we rest completely with God, that there is no more crying, that there is no more pain, there is no more suffering. So when we're talking about rest, we're not talking about rest from all of that, because even the Israelites, they had battles to fight. Even when they were in the land, they had battles to fight. And so too do we have battles to fight. But we're reminded in Scripture that our battle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers and the powers of this dark age. Satan himself. And those who do his bidding. We are called to rest in Christ, that the victory has already been won on the cross. The victory has already been won on the cross. Are you going to enter into that rest? Are you going to remain faithful to him as you rest in him? In Hebrews we get the synopsis of the gospel, as I said. It is the good news, the word of God. The gospel is a message of our salvation. The gospel is a message of our justification. Being made right with God. Salvation from sin. Justification, being made right with God. It is a message of our sanctification. Being made holy and set apart for God. Being made into the likeness of his Son. But it is also the message of our glorification when we receive our inheritance with the Son in eternity. That is the gospel we believe, and that is what Hebrews is telling us. And it is all through Jesus. It is all through Jesus. Not what we have done, not what we think, not what we can do, but in what Christ has done, his death, his resurrection, his ascension. The Word of God. The Gospel. So in conclusion, Hebrews is the Gospel message. Hebrews reminds us that Jesus is God. That Jesus is over all of creation. That he is the image of God. If we want to know what God looks like, we look to Jesus. We see his nature. We see his character. We see his compassion, his love, his forgiveness, his mercy, his grace. And we see it all in the image of God through the Son. Jesus is greater because he goes before everything. He is before everything. He is greater because what goes before simply points to him. They were not the main act. Jesus is. Jesus, and because Jesus is greater, we are called to remain faithful to him. Not to cast him aside and return to something else. A past revelation, a past understanding, but to remain faithful to him, because he is the image of God. He is God. And we are called to enter the rest that God has promised us now, as we rest in our salvation in him, and to enter it fully in eternity. To receive our full reward, the victor's crown that has been prepared for you because of Christ. Are you going to remain faithful today? Are you going to remain in the rest that Christ gives you today? Are you going to believe in him and receive your salvation? Amen. Shall we pray? Lord God, we thank you for sending Jesus. We thank you, Lord, that he was obedient, that he came down to earth, that he lived a perfect life. A sinless life, a life in obedience to you, his Father. Lord, that he even was obedient to death on the cross. And that through his obedience, you accepted his sacrifice, you raised him up, and he now sits at your right hand in the seat of power and authority. Lord, we thank you, Lord, that you call us to rest with him. To rest in him, to put our trust and our hope for today and eternity in him. Help us to live faithful lives today. In your name, Lord, I pray. Amen. We're going to sing together before we have our announcements. How great is our God? Oh yes, we'll also take up the offering, thank you. Thank you. couple of announcements this morning. First of all, we have a barbecue after the service. If you haven't brought anything, don't worry. I hope there's enough to go around, so please feel free to stay. We're going to be out that side at the back. But with that in mind, obviously things need to be set up, so we're going to set up the barbecue. It'll take a little time to cook some of the meat that's been brought as well, so be patient with that. But we will need help getting chairs and tables out there as well. So if you're able to help with that, please do. Noel, Sean, if you could coordinate that for us, just to make sure that that's out. Then Bible studies this Tuesday are recommencing. Before that, we'll go to the slide before that actually. Tonight, I'm running 5K in aid of Love Both. There is a sponsorship form on the back table there, next to the sign up sheet. So if you haven't signed in, please sign in. And also there's a sponsorship form there as well. But also you can, on the church's Facebook page, there's a link to GoFundMe page, which links to the Love Both GoFundMe campaign. And you can donate through there as well, if you don't want to do that with cash here. And so just to let you know that I'm doing that tonight. And then as I say, Tuesday, our Bible studies are recommencing at 8 o'clock. Nancy's, John and Maggie's, is it on yours this week?
Yes.
Yeah, excellent. Thank you, John. And then Friday, this coming Friday, the 10th of September, we've got our Accelerate Youth, that's for everyone in secondary school. 8 o'clock at mine and Nancy's. This is a social evening. And then a week on Tuesday, week on Wednesday, so the 15th of September, and we will start our youth Bible studies. And with that, for the parents of the youth, I have some letters for you here, just explaining our programme for the coming year. So if you want to get that, to remind me, because I forgot to give them out last week. So just to remind me, if you haven't already received, to claim your letter, it just explains everything up to Christmas, what we're doing. Okay? Just so you sure you're aware. And then next Sunday, the 12th of September, we'll meet here again at 10:30 for our worship as we gather together as God's people. Our benediction this morning before we go, and we continue to share fellowship over our barbecue. From John chapter 20, and snippets from 26, 27, and 28. Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you. Do not disbelieve, but believe." And Thomas answered, "My Lord and my God." Amen. That's my prayer for each one of us. I will be able to say, "My Lord and my God." God bless you.